Hi, you guys. I hope you're well. We're going to move on to membrane dynamics, chapter 5. And this is going to encompass diffusion, transport, membrane proteins, all sorts of transport through that membrane. I want to first direct you to question 19 of level 4 questions at the end of this chapter. It has a very interesting study on patients with arthritis. Some undergo surgery, some do not, and the results that came from that study. So I urge you to look at that. That's one of your assignments. Also, in covering this chapter, I need to refer back to chapter 3. Chapter 3 has more of the basics of the membrane itself, and that's what I want to show you here. Here we're looking with the purple balls, we're looking at phospholipids. Phospholipid head and the phospholipid tails. And this is sliced down the middle so that you can see the lower section that goes towards the inside of the cell and the outer section that goes towards the outside of the cell. Other than that, there are some glycolipids inserted here. And just like that, there's some glycoproteins, which means long carbohydrate chains that are inserted onto those proteins that are going to transverse that membrane. Notice that they do that only to the external part of the cell and not towards the internal part, which would be down here. We say the cell membrane is fluid. It is. It bounces around quite a bit because it's a lipid, and those proteins are floating among those lipids. So they do have quite a bit of mobility. Those proteins, remember, are going to form channels that are going to allow molecules in or out of the cell that could otherwise not cross the membrane. In more detail, we want to look at the phospholipid structure. There are very many ways to show what that phospholipid looks like. So the easiest, simplest is the stylized model where you have this purple head and two legs or two tails. Really, if you wanted to see a little more detail on that, you know that what that means is that there's a whole molecule up here, which includes glycerol and a phosphate. Very important because it has a charge. So that polar head with that glycerol and phosphate is hydrophilic, because it has a charge, and if it has a charge, it will get along with water. The legs here, or the tails, however, are fatty, and those do not get along with water. So if you think of the lipid bilayer again, the polar heads point to the outside of the cell, which is a watery environment. The inverted head on the lower level points to the inside of the cell because that's also a watery environment. In more detail yet, what is glycerol? Glycerol is a very simple molecule, three carbon chain with its hydrogens and hydroxyls attached onto it. And a fatty acid is a very long chain of carbon with less oxygen. It's a fat, so that ratio of carbon to oxygen is not maintained as it is in a carbohydrate. Lots of carbons, lots of hydrogens, not so many oxygens. That is a fatty acid. A stylized view of this is helpful, where molecules, if I can enlarge this, yeah. Remember that molecules are moving, but if we draw it like this, then we have our stylized model here of the phospholipids, now with blue balls, a protein that's going to form a channel, a different type of protein that's going to form something we call a carrier, and I will give you more detail on the difference between a carrier and a channel just in a little bit. And there's your glycoprotein that has also a protein and the carbohydrate chain attached on there, plus some cholesterol that tends to be among these phospholipids. Really nice model, including the different types of molecules as a model. They don't really look like that, for you to understand this better. The cell membrane function, I want to stress over and over again, is such an important function. I put a fence here for you because a fence is what's not going to let the horses, in this case, out, but it will let a rabbit come through. So that's what the cell membrane is going to do in a cell. It's going to allow some substances to come through and block others. It's a boundary for that living thing. And if that cell gets it wrong and allows in something it shouldn't, or allows out something it shouldn't, that cell is going to die. So that function of that membrane is very, very important. The first thing is fluid balance must be held throughout the body. What's that mean? It means that water needs to be in the right compartment. You can't accumulate water all of a sudden outside a cell, or accumulate it inside a cell, because you could potentially burst the cell. So where to put water? As a big picture, in the whole body, there must be a balance. The amount of water that comes in must be distributed, and then some of it must be eliminated, and we do that through the kidneys. So the kidney is a big regulator of water. If you have loss of balance, you might have dehydration. So which are the fluid compartments that we have to think of in the body? This picture is not a boulder going down a road. It's my attempt to just draw a cell very close to a blood vessel. So in thinking of the fluid compartments, we're going to think of three. One is, where is that fluid inside a cell? The first place is it will be inside a cell. The second one is it won't be inside the cell. It'll be outside the cell. And what are the locations that it might be? Well, it might be floating around in the tissue, or it might be in the blood. So those are the three: within the cell or not. If it's not, it's going to be in the tissues. So I'm going to have it around here surrounding the cell, or it's going to be circulating in the blood here, my little river. Okay, so compartment 1, 2, and 3 on the outside. We must maintain that balance in order for there to be homeostasis that we've talked about, the dynamic constancy of the internal environment. Can't get too hot, we can't get too cold, we can't get too hungry, too thirsty. We have to be regulating that all the time, and the cells are going to help do that. There's a very interesting story about a radio contest where you could see, it's illustrated how water in the wrong compartments can actually be fatal. There was a radio contest way back in 2007 called Hold Your Wee for a Wee. You would win a wee for the television if you could drink a lot of water and not eliminate it, not pee. And three contestants were there, one large male, a more petite female. And the very tragic end to the story was that the more petite female drank a lot of water trying to win a wee for her children. She didn't feel well. She drove home, she lay down, and she died. And it was a very, very tragic story of water being in the wrong compartments. That case went to court and there was a settlement, and but still, I put this slide in because people always ask me, well, what happened later? What happened is that that fluid was diluting many cells in her body. And by diluting that, all of a sudden, the system starts to shut down. So what we need is equilibrium, right? We need the body to be in this osmotic equilibrium throughout the different compartments. So the individual ions are not in equilibrium, but the overall volume of solute per volume of fluid must be the same in all the fluid compartments. I'm going to stop this now and start again with the slide on the next mini lecture. Thank you.